It's Absolute Radio, it's Home Time, and our guest today, William Hague, hello.
Hello, nice to be here.
Yeah, nice to have you. Does anyone ever call you the Hagenator?
No.
Can I call you the Hagenator?
Well, you can.
It's making you uncomfortable, isn't it?
Yes, a little bit.
I'm not going to do
However, you can do what I've been called much worse things, so you can call me whatever you like, I'm sure.
I need to get something out of the way straight away, so I'm going to play a piece of music to introduce the segment, which I think will do that job for us. So can we have that? Now, I know you're not a big rock and roll fan. You're into your jazz and your classical music. This is right, yeah?
You're right. You've done your research well.
But that was, of course, The Who and Substitute. Now, we've had all the leaders. We've invited all the leaders on the programme.
Yeah.
Everybody said yes, apart from David Cameron. So, obviously, I feel a bit snubbed and my feelings are hurt that he chose the readers of Heat magazine over the listeners of Absolute Radio.
You look like you've got over it, then.
Well, you know, I'm hiding it. Tears of a clown. But I want to know, like, from a leader's point of view, which is, of course, something you did, how do you choose these things? How do you choose what's important? How do you prioritise?
Well, you have to see what you can fit in. There's a huge number of interviews in an election campaign. I think when I was leader in the 2001 election, there were something like 660 interviews in the course of the election campaign. But if you're the Prime Minister, of course, you are still the Prime Minister as well. You know, remember, he is still taking the calls from the foreign leaders and running the country at the same time. So he can't always do as many as the other party leaders.
I don't want you to feel unappreciated for being
well,
here.
Well, I don't want you to feel snubbed anyway. I'm sure he would be delighted to be here.
Because this is the end of an illustrious parliamentary career for you. You're not even standing at this election.
I'm not standing, no.
And yet you're here campaigning. What is that? Are you working your notice period? What's going on here?
It's not quite like that. No, I care about the result. I care about the country. And so, yeah, I'm not a candidate, but I'm working as hard as in any election in which I have been a candidate. Because I think as someone who's been in 26 years in Parliament, I owe that to my colleagues. Giving a bit back, yeah. Exactly. And I do really care about the result. This is an important election. I know politicians always say this is the most important election in a long time. But in terms of the choice of what direction the country is going in...
And it's difficult. It's very difficult. Very no one can call
one.
It.
Very important. So I'm doing as much as I can to help my colleagues before I
vanish.
Quit the scene in 3 weeks' time.
I want to talk about when you were first campaigning. Were you going door to door in Yorkshire?
Yes.
Did you ever have one of those experiences, like where you're bitten by a dog or chased by a lady with a rolling pin?
Not chased by a rolling pin. I've certainly been. I'm sure I've met a few vicious dogs. I mean, this was all in. This is all in South York, what we used to call the Socialist Republic of South Yorkshire.
Right.
You know, which was very, very Labour in the 1970s, and I was a Conservative. And I used to get a fair bit of abuse. I once went down a pit with a blue rosette.
Wow, and you came back up.
And came out alive just after the miners' strike as well. So I was used to fighting elections, you know, with the odds stacked heavily against me. Which was good preparation for being leader of the party in 2001.
Yeah. And your experience with making rounds as well, because your parents were soft drink. They had a soft drinks company, Hague's Soft Drinks.
They had a soft drinks family business. My job was to go and deliver the pop.
And what are the perks of that job? If your parents have that, that's their line of business. What are the perks
I know
as
where
a
you're
kid?
Yeah. Heading to. Yes, that was a pint of beer at each stop.
Oh, I wasn't heading there.
Yes,
I was saving that
till
later. I promise you I wasn't. I was saving that till later. I was thinking about the perks of, from purely being a kid and soft drinks.
No, well, I thought you had as much lemonade as you wanted to.
Yeah.
But that was my vacation job. It wasn't going to be a career for me.
Mm. And there was no disappointment on your dad's behalf that you weren't going to take
over the
family business.
There was no disappointment because he sold up, you know, which was good for his retirement, rather than me going... carry on the business.
Something I was curious to ask you, as a fellow northerner, when you left Yorkshire to go into Oxford and then Parliament, which certainly back then it was less frequent that you would hear a regional accent, did you have any sort of sense of feeling like an oik? Did people ever sort of do the old northerner jokes with you?
Well, a little bit, but I always felt not socially inferior, but if anything, equal or superior to all these public school boys and all of that who I met at Oxford. I never felt in any way that was a disadvantage in life. That I came from a comprehensive school in Yorkshire, did have a different accent from a lot of them. I always thought that was an advantage in life, and I've always treated it as such. And a lot of this is in your own mental attitude, actually. A lot of barriers fall away if you assume they're not there.
I can give you a list of names. Michael Foot, Neil Kinnock, yourself, Ian Duncan-Smith, Michael Howard.
They're all leaders of the Labour and Conservative parties who didn't become Prime Minister.
What else, though?
All very interesting people.
All bald.
All bald.
Do you think there's anything in that? Do you think the British electorate don't want a bald Prime Minister?
Michael Foot.
Come on, there was a lot going. There was a lot of shiny going.
No, I think you're stretching a point there. Michael Foot was famous for his hair, so you can't include
him. Not the top
of it. You can't include him in a list of people who were bald.
Well, you've just ruined my theory, William.
I have ruined the theory.
Why? That's because
it's not a very good theory. I have to point out.
While you were leader, Prime Minister's Question Time, I think in some ways that could be described as the last golden age of Prime Minister's Question Time. And you have Blair, who was this slick, almost like an ad man, and you took a very different approach, and you would often run circles around him. And that was something you picked up from John Smith, right?
Yes, I used to admire the late John Smith. Remember, he was the Labour leader who died in 1994, which is when Tony Blair came in. But I always thought he was a really effective parliamentarian. He could make us laugh at our own leaders.
Yeah.
And, you know, Tony Blair was so all-powerful at the beginning. Such a big majority in Parliament, ahead in all opinion polls. Nobody could really say a word against him and get a fair hearing. I thought, well, at least I can start to get the ridicule of somebody who is doing a lot of things wrong at the time. I thought, but that's only now.
But it wasn't just point scoring and name calling like it can be now.
No.
Because most recently you've been leader of the House of Commons, and you are you're an advocate of a rowdy parliament, right?
Well, of a vigorous parliament, which is rowdy at times. I'm an advocate of parliament doing a lot of hard work as well. But I always said there are quiet parliaments in the world, but they are in Pyongyang and Beijing.
But also some of the European countries as well. That's my bald head theory, just using those two to make an argument.
Yeah. I think it's a little stronger than that theory. We have a vigorous democracy, and now and again people get excited about that. But I am an advocate of that. But yes, at Prime Minister's Questions, I didn't have a lot else going for me at that time. I tried to raise the morale of my party, show that we could win the arguments, even if we weren't winning anything else at the time, by winning at Prime Minister's Question Time.
So what do you then make of the disgust that the public have for the way people behave in Prime Minister's Question Time now? It's something that the public kind of lost faith in MPs, and a lot's been done to restore faith with the expenses and so on, but I think that's one particular thing that people see, look at how they behave in there. Do you think that is something that's due for a change?
Well, we should always be open to improvements, but I'm not sure how you would change that without throwing the baby out with the bathwater. You know,
what about a man actually answering questions without people on either side jeering and shouting?
Well, if you ask Parliament to just keep completely quiet about everything, then it's not going to be our vigorous Parliament. I think the answer is to show people more of the rest of the work Parliament does. Okay,
right, yeah.
For half an hour a week, there is a rowdy Prime Minister's Question Time. But what's going on the rest of the time? MPs are sitting in committees going over the details of legislation. Then people would say, well, that's too boring to watch. Well, it probably is too boring to watch, but that's because they are doing the serious detailed work. And I think it's important to understand that is all going on as well in Parliament.
Have you ever fallen asleep in Parliament?
No, I haven't. Well, not in the actual... not while giving a speech. I don't think I've sat on the green benches.
Congratulations.
They're not very... By the way, they wouldn't be very comfortable.
Some people do manage it, which is it's remarkable.
Well, they have to be pretty exhausted, or I don't know. They wouldn't be very comfortable to go to sleep on. You can, of course, hear better if you put your head back. that's the excuse. The amplifiers for the sound are in the wood.
So you're doing
behind you.
And it can get drowned out by the snoring.
It can look like you're resting your head when actually you are, of course, listening carefully.
Intently. The second bit of music I want to play in to start the interview is this. Now, you'll recognise this as chopsticks because you, after you were leader of the opposition, you learned piano for a while.
I did learn the piano. I started the day I stood down as leader of the opposition. I thought I will start a new life, and symbolising that, I'm going to learn music for the first time. And I started from you know, where is Middle C?
And how good did you get? Did you do any grades?
Well, I didn't do grades because I think I've done enough exams in my life, but I was getting up to, when I stopped playing because I went back into politics, I was learning to play Moonlight Sonata. I was up to that, which I suppose
very
would
nice.
Be a grade four
yeah,
level
like that.
Sort of piece. And I played a lot of Chopin and Bach and Beethoven. And I'm looking for one of the things I'm looking forward to leaving politics is I will open the piano lid again and start again.
And have you kept up the judo?
Not very much. I keep fit, but I used to do a lot of judo with Seb Coe.
Yeah. And what belt did you get?
Well, I got to a blue belt at that.
Is that the second one down?
Yes, or fourth one up, whatever, right. whichever way you're.
So if we were out on the street and it started to kick off, you'd be able to help me out here.
Well, I wouldn't advise getting into a fight on the street.
If I went to strike you now, you'd be able to have me on the floor like that, right?
I would certainly do that, yeah.
Imagine I'm John Burke. Yeah. Hey, I'll tell you who I bet would enjoy that detail about you is Vladimir Putin.
He probably would. I took him to the judo at the Olympics.
Yeah.
It was the happiest meeting we've had with Mr. Putin, with President Putin. We've had a lot of trouble with him, a lot of unhappy meetings. But he really enjoyed coming to the XL Centre, seeing the Olympics. It was, as it was for Britain, a great moment in the world.
Yeah.
It was for our relations with Russia.
I'd love to talk to you about Putin, what you really think, but it could, like, you're aware that anything you could say could cause a diplomatic incident, right?
Well, I'm aware we're speaking to all your listeners.
Yeah.
And yes, I should not cause diplomatic incidents.
Which world leaders are the most fun? Who have you met who we would think is a laugh? Who's the most personable?
Well, Hillary Clinton's in the news. She's just announced her run for the presidency. I always got on with her extremely well. And she would say sometimes, why we've been in a meeting all day, why don't we go out and have a drink? And we used to go out and have a drink when she was Secretary of State and I was Foreign Secretary. And so she was quite good fun to be around.
Did you ever get to go on Air Force One?
No, I haven't been on Air Force One. Hillary wasn't the president.
No, of course not. Yeah,
at this stage.
Not
so,
yet.
No, I haven't been on Air Force One.
What's the most opulent, like, when you're visiting dignitaries and embassies and so on abroad? What's the most opulent place you've seen?
Oh, well, of course, some of the Arab leaders live in pretty substantial palaces.
And do you ever get served anything like roasted penguin and you have to force it down because, you know, it's the local custom?
I think I'd probably refuse to eat a roasted penguin. no, I haven't had that. But there are straight... I have drunk... recently visiting the president of Mongolia, you know, the custom is to sit down and drink mare's milk as you have the meeting. And so
how is it?
That's what I do. Well, I just drank these things and thought of England.
It's looking very likely that we're going to have some form of minority or coalition government the next time, or this time round. And you, of course, have been in government with a majority. You've been in government with a coalition. I'm guessing you are not a fan of the coalition way of doing things. You're a big first-past-the-post guy, right?
No, I am. We need a majority government. I negotiated the coalition. I was, but we had to. That was... You have to deal with the play with the cards the electorate deal you. But we're certainly not wanting another coalition. We need a clear majority government, and we can still get one. By the way, don't presume what the result is going to be.
It's looking a certain way, but anything can happen.
The last election, I remember when everybody was saying that in 1992. I've been around long enough now to have seen all these elections.
Yeah.
There was a majority.
Yeah.
The pundits are often wrong about these things.
Mm. Is being leader of a political party a bit like running a coalition? Because there's such a breadth. Like, the Conservative Party isn't people with our view. It's a whole broad spectrum of things. And I think of when you first went into Parliament, you voted for the lowering of age of consent in for gay sex to 16, and then you ended up being leader of a party where you were very like protective of Section 28. And I don't think it's not because you became homophobic.
No,
it's because
there's a broad spread. That's exactly right.
So it's a bit like handling a party, but on a bigger scale, a coalition.
Well, it is, except of course, when a party is elected on its own, it can then implement its manifesto that it went to the country on. If it's a coalition, you have to put the two together. There is then a bargaining process from which the voters are not taking part. They're excluded.
It must be quite nice to, at the end of the Parliament, say, well, it was in our manifesto, but we had to form a coalition, so it's not our fault.
Well, but then there are things that you wanted to do that you're not able to do. So,
yeah.
No, I wouldn't recommend a coalition, and we can get a Conservative majority in this election. It will be a pretty chaotic outlook if there isn't. You know, what mixture of other parties can be put together.
So finally then, are you having a leaving do?
No, I mean, my fellow MPs gave me a bit of a leaving do when Parliament was dissolved. Yeah. And they're all very nice to me, but that's it. No, my leaving do is hopefully celebrating a Conservative win in the general election. That would be a big enough party for me.
Well, you know, thank you so much for coming in.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.